That may be paid in the night, but joy comes in the morning. And when the oceans rage, I don't have to be afraid, because I know that you love me. Continue to worship the Lord.
Sitting at your feet is where I wanna be. I'm home when I am here with you. Ruined by your grace, enamored by your gaze, can't resist tenderness in you. Father, Father,
God of creation, there at the start, before the beginning of time. With no point of reference, you spoke to the dark and fleshed out the wonder of light. And as you speak, 100 billion galaxies are born in the vapor of your breath, the planet. The stars are made to worship, so alive. I can see your heart in everything you made. Every burning star, a signal fire of grace. If creation sings your praises, so alive. So alive, God of your promise, you don't speak in vain, a syllable empty or void. Once you have spoken, nature and science follow the sound of your voice. Ooh, and as you speak, 100 billion creatures catch your breath, evolving in pursuit of what you say. It all reveals your nature so alive. I can see your heart in everything you say. Every painted sky, a canvas of your grace. If creation still obeys you, so alive.
Whoa!
out my heart through all of my failures and pride. On a hill you created the light of the world, abandoned in darkness to die. And as you speak, 100 billion failures disappear. Where you lost your life so I could find it here. If you left the grave behind you, so will I. I can see your heart in everything you've done. Every part designed a work of art called love. If you gladly chose surrender, so will I. I can see your heart a billion different ways. Every precious one, a child you died to save. If you gave your life to love them, so alive. Like you would again 100 billion times. For a measure could amount to your desire. You're the one who never leaves the one behind. And as you speak, 100 billion failures disappear. Come on, let's sing that to the Lord. Where you lost your life so I could find it here. If you left the grave behind you, so alive. See your heart in everything you've done. Every part designed in a work of art called love. If you gladly chose surrender, so alive. I can see your heart a billion different ways. Every precious one, a child you died to save. If you gave your life to love it, so will I. Yes, Father, for we will praise you just like the stars do.
I worship you.
worship you. You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. Yeah, I worship you. I worship you.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you.
Darkness, my God, that is who you are.
you. You're here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You know, as you are standing right now, just continue to worship him. Because, Father, we are here for you. And I pray that all of us that have sang this song, Father, that we believe that you are the way maker, the miracle worker, the promise keeper, and the light in the darkness. Father, I pray that we just claim it into our lives. Yes, Father, we just thank you for your presence. That is who you are. Keep light in the darkness, my God. That is who you are. Come on, just sing it to him, church. This time that you gave us, Father, to lift up your name, to sing to you, to honor you. Father, I pray that for the rest of the service, that your presence just remains here, Father. Father, that throughout the service we feel at ease, we feel peace, Father, with anything that is just going bad in our lives, Father, that you just make it all at ease right now, Father. For we just claim it right now in this church. That, Father, that we just receive more of you today. And even after we get out of church, Father, that your love is still planted inside of us and your presence always remains. Father, for your spirit is just so powerful and mighty. That, Father, why wouldn't we want to have it? Why wouldn't we want to walk around daily with you, Father? Father, that through you, we can do anything. That through you, doors will open up, Father. That through you, doors will close. Father, for you all are our Father, Father. I know I said that at the same time, but Father, you are just so amazing, and you're our Savior, our healer. We just thank you for this time, and we thank you for your love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning and welcome. Our God is so awesome. Such a wonderful time of worship.
Before we get started this morning, I would like for us all to honor another group of men and women who are part of our body. We have It's not working. I can hear it. Let's never.
Thank you for that. Every day, every moment that you served in the armed services, you fortified the foundations that give us the freedom to stand here, to worship the Lord, to live our daily lives in the in this wonderful country, still the best in the world. And I'd just like to ask for a round of applause in honor of the vets that are here. Thank you. We're still in the best country. And we are a part of a wonderful fellowship here. If you have your bulletins, and thank you for coming today. If you have your bulletins, if you're new, there are newcomers bags outside. There is also on the back of your bulletin a little note, connect with us. If you're here and you feel like you haven't connected with anyone here yet, haven't heard from anyone, fill out the back of this. We would love to talk to you. We would love to get to know you. And occasionally I hear of someone that's kind of been here for a while and doesn't know anyone yet. So let us know, because we don't want anybody to feel unloved or unwelcome here. You are all very welcome. We are all just kind of spaced out and don't always see the ones we need to give a hug right in front of us. So fill out that little book, that little connect with us. And if you have any prayer requests, if you are in the hospital, going in the hospital, just having an issue that you'd like for the body of Christ to raise you up in prayer, fill that out on the back. Every Monday night, group of prayer warriors meets at the Davidson's house. Well, actually, this week, it will be at the Payne's house, and that information's in the bulletin. So gather with us on Monday nights. If you can't gather with us, if you need prayer for someone in your family, someone you know, put it in one of those connect with us requests, and we will lift them up. Our God hears our prayers. I was reminded yesterday that even after we have said our prayers and we forget, God still remembers. Our prayers are his incense in his hands. And he still remembers and hears and is still working on everything that we've asked in his son's name. So let's use that power and come before his throne at any moment. Arrow prayers quick during the day, on our knees whenever we can. There are several things in the bulletin to take a look at. We are in the midst of collecting for regalos. Yay! The kids are really active in that. That is coming to an end. And so, dig deep. We have buckets up here that don't have enough money in them. Usually at this time of year, you can barely pick these up. It hasn't been quite the same contest this year, and we still need the same amount of money for the children. These are those precious little ones of the Lord, and so contribute your change, your bills, so that we can help give them a Merry Christmas. And with the Christmas gifts, we also pass out information about the Lord. So this is definitely an outreach that's about reaching little ones for Jesus Christ. We still have need for some toys and some hygiene items for the collection. We're a little low on, let's see, what are we a little low on? Cars and Hot Wheels. We're a little low on soap, toothbrushes, toothpaste, socks and bandanas, crayons. So pick them up this week. We need to get them up here and get them out to the kids. If you've got coats that you want to bring for the box that's out front, bring them in. They're going to those that would be without otherwise. Our giving is so important to the Lord. There are so many that without our giving would not receive the basic necessities, would not receive pamphlets about the Lord in their own language, just would not know. And the tithing that you do here at this church, in addition to the giving, is so important to keep the Lord's work going forward. We do so much in this area. We feed the homeless. We work with the kids. We do the prison ministry. And folks, it may sound materialistic, but we have to have the money to get it done. We have to have the resources to do it. So reach down and just out of gratitude for everything your Father's given you, give back for those others that need it. We have fellowship opportunities this week. In the bulletin, we talk about the prayer meeting. We also talk about the opportunities to come and listen to the word and have a meal with your brothers and sisters and get to know them. The men's Bible study is not listed in the bulletin this week, but they're still meeting every Tuesday at 8 a.m. and then at 6:30 p.m. So, men, come, strengthen yourselves. Your most important mission in life is to be strong men of God for your family. Encourage one another, strengthen one another, seek to lift up your family, pray for them. So join us in the ministry opportunities. There are lists on the back table of activities that are available, ministries that are available to those. The Care Net is available for those who may have had an abortion, who may be considering an abortion. There are activities listed back there. There's usually information about our prison ministries always going on. And now there's also going to be a training this next week, and Jim Pollard is going to talk to you about that. Better luck with Mike.
Thank you, Kathy. Good morning. I just want to let you know, Kathy mentioned it last week, we're putting on a class this Saturday, the 16th, it's called Stop the Bleed. And it's put on by the American College of Surgeons. And we're so blessed. Lori Hernandez has set this up for us. And it's open to the whole church, just not the safety team or the in-service people, but for everyone to know how to use a tourniquet to stop a bleed that is going to bleed you out. You can bleed to death when you have an artery that is punctured. You can bleed to death within 4 to 5 minutes. And so this class will show you the different parts of your body that you can put a tourniquet on to stop the bleeding and save a life. This could be for yourself, for your family, for your neighbors, for our community. So I pray that you will take advantage of this. The sign-up sheet is in the back, again, open to all of the church. If you have friends that you think might be interested, sign them up. We'd love to have them come because this is so, so important. Again, this Saturday, November 16th at 9:30 here at the church. So if you have any questions, please contact me. I'll be happy to answer any. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jim. I was ready to get up here. If you got your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Luke. How about them Baylor Bears? Yeah. I don't want to hear nothing else but good stuff about the Baylor Bears. So as we are looking in the Gospels, we are trying to follow the timeline of Jesus' birth. How many of you are excited about Christmas coming? Some of you. Most of you that are excited don't have to buy a lot of presents probably. Even my wife said that she wants to put her tree up before Thanksgiving. I said, "What? We've never in a million years did that." She said, "Well, we're doing it this year." just feels like getting into the spirit of Christmas. And it's interesting because with the beautifulness of that Christmas is with its lights and all its glitter, it's really, for a Christian, it's much more than all that. I mean, so much more than all this. And I would pray that we would take that in consideration going into this holiday season to kind of remember what the holiday's for and to remember what Christmas is really about, at least for Christians. I know that there's a lot of secular ways that that different religions and different people have said about Christmas and its pagan roots and all that. I'm here to tell you that I think that God has blessed us as Americans, and He gives some of us our own traditions. A lot of us were raised Jewish. A lot of us were raised in that Jewish culture. We were just heathens and just enjoying life, and I believed in Santa Claus for a long time, till I was about 4. No, I'm just kidding. I think I learned real early. I have a lot of older cousins. You know, they were busting our bubbles real early in life. I got to be careful to talk about that with the little kids in here. Get in trouble. Anyway, sorry about that if I busted a bubble. But church is where you hear the truth. Supposed to. So, anyways, we're excited for Christmas. But for us, I'm excited that I'm teaching the Gospels through the Christmas season. And today we're going to look at a very special announcement. Last week we saw how John the Baptist was prophesied by the angel that Zechariah, his dad, would be a father. And the interesting thing is Zechariah, you know, it says they were up in age, so maybe 60, 70 years old, if not older. And it's interesting that Elizabeth, John the Baptist's mother, was also up in age, past childbearing age. And yet Mary, who's her cousin, is so much younger. So it kind of gives you an idea that the families were big at the time, that there were a lot of people in a family. But in Luke chapter 1, we're going to start in verse 25. It says, Thus the Lord has dealt with me in the days when he looked upon me to take away my reproach among the people. It's interesting that Elizabeth would look at herself as a reproach since she never had any children, and God at the end of her life has blessed her. So let me tell you this, your life at this moment may be in darkness. But believe in the God who you serve and the God that you love and that loves you, that he will not leave you in that darkness. He'll only leave you in that darkness if you want to stay there. Your faith has to rise you out, your trust and belief in God doing something else. Your circumstances may not be changing at the moment, but your faith in the God who changes circumstances can do that for you. So that's part of our responsibility. And it says, now in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary. And having come in, the angel said to her, "Rejoice, highly favored one. The Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women." How many of you in here were raised Catholic? There's a lot of us. You recognize that phrase right there, "Blessed are you among women." That's in the Hail Mary, right? This is what the angel said to Mary. But what he was expressing was grace was put upon her, that God had put grace on her to be the mother of Jesus, the mother of the Messiah. Now, every young girl's Jewish dream, every young Jewish girl's dream was to be the mother of the Messiah. The Messiah has been prophesied for many years, thousands of years, and the Jewish people were anticipating his arrival, and they knew that they were going to come through a young virgin. A young woman, because Isaiah tells us that. It says, so, but when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and considered what manner of greeting this was. Now, I'm going to get into to who Mary was and some interesting things about Mary. It says, but when she saw him, she was troubled at his saying and considered what manner of greeting this was. Then the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son and shall call his name Jesus," or Yahshua. "He will be great and he will be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom there will be no end." Then Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I do not know a man?" I mean, she has never been with a man in a Jewish culture. A young girl, once she had her first period, her menstrual cycle, which was 11, 12 years old. The Jewish culture would celebrate that because that was her coming of age and becoming a woman. And also could be betrothed in marriage and start setting up her destiny and her future with her future husband. Now, when she's born and they're growing up, the parents are already looking for potentials. They're already looking for a husband. They're already looking to make a deal. And so, Mary is asking the angel and saying, how can this be? She's not like Zechariah, who questioned the fact that God said you're going to have a son and doubted and didn't believe. And so he's, remember right now, Zechariah can't speak. So for 6 months, where this has been 6 months later, he hadn't said a word. Mary is not doubting what the Lord is telling her. Mary is not understanding what the Lord is saying to her fully. And that's all of us. We have those kind of questions. We hear promises. We hear things. We don't fully understand what God means in His Word. And so sometimes it takes to be taught it and to break it down and to look and to read other passages and realize, because in Isaiah 7, which Mary knew, then he said to her, here now, house of David, is it a small thing for you to weary men, but will you weary my God also? This is Isaiah talking to Ahaz, the king. Therefore, the Lord himself would give you a sign. Then all of a sudden, he turns from speaking over the king to just speaking in the distant future. How the Holy Spirit just came over him and spoke over the future. It said, behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. Very powerful, very, very powerful scripture. And the Jewish people would train their kids in the scriptures, and they would rehearse them, they'd learn them, and they memorize them, and they knew what the scripture said. Mary knew this. And the angel said to her, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the highest will overshadow you. Therefore also the Holy One who is to be born will be called the Son of God. Now indeed, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age. And this is now the sixth month for her who was called barren. For with God, nothing will be impossible. Keep that in mind. Then Mary said, behold, the maidservant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. And the angel departed from her. She grabbed a hold of what he said. She grabbed a hold of the word that came from the Lord through the angel. And she planted in her heart. Listen, that's us as well. We should be ones who hear the word of God and make it ours and confess it and claim it and say, I believe that. That's mine. I trust that. He will never leave me nor forsake me. He will meet all my needs according to his goodness, his power. It says, then Mary said, behold, the maidservant of the Lord, let it be to me according to your word. And the angel departed from her. Now Mary arose in those days and went into the hill country with haste to the city of Judah and entered the house of Zacharias and greeted Elizabeth. And it happened when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary that the babe leaped in her womb and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. Notice how the child in the womb responded to the voice of Mary. It is not tissue in there. It is a person in there. Then she spoke out with a loud voice and said, blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. That is not a prayer. That is a praise. That is not her starting the prayer that the Catholics use to pray to Mary. This is just a statement and a blessing over her. But why is this granted to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For indeed, as soon as the voice of your greeting sounded in my ears, the babe leaped in my womb for joy. Blessed is she who believed, for there will be fulfillment of those things which were told her from the Lord. Notice, she believed what the Lord said, and she's going to be blessed by it. Claim these promises for yourself. Claim them for yourself. Even if you don't see the evidence of the truth, claim those promises and rest in them. And don't let your mind lie to you and tell you God is not with you, because he is. It says, blessed is she who believed, for there will be fulfillment of those things which were told her from the Lord. And Mary said, listen to this prayer, my soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior. Notice what she says. God, my Savior. In our Catholic teaching, we believe that Mary was part of the healing process between us and God, mediator. in Catholic churches, she becomes somebody to pray to, a saint that mediates for us. She is telling us from her own words, if we would pay attention, that she herself sees Jesus, the one in her womb, as her Savior. Because Mary, also born of the seed of Adam, was a sinner. I remember in my early Christian life talking to Catholics and trying to understand why they were still believing when I was learning these new things and going, what about this? I mean, with your Catholic faith, what about this? And I remember just getting to some debates and listening to what some of those said about their faith in Mary, and that she also ascended to heaven like Jesus did. That she is also a co-redeemer. Mary is not that. Mary recognizes right here when she says, in God my Savior. She's claiming it as her own. For he has regarded the lowly state of his maidservant. For behold, henceforth all generations will call me blessed. For he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. I will tell you this, that she was the number one woman. She got to bear the Lord. That is a blessing. My mom says she's blessed for having me. But she's the only one. Maybe my wife will say it. You're blessed because you gave me that. For he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. Not her name, his name. And his mercy, not her mercy, his mercy is on those who fear him. From generation to generation, he has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in their imagination of their hearts. He has put down the mighty from their thrones and exalted the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his seed forever. She knows her history. She knows her religion. She knows the promises of God. In Galatians chapter 4, referring back to Mary, here's what we need to understand. Paul explains this. He said, now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, does not differ at all from a slave, talking about going from the law to grace, though he is master of all, but is under guardians and stewardships until the time appointed by the Father. Even so we, when we were children, were in bondage under the elements of the world, which means our parents controlled everything that we did. Then it says this, but when the fullness of the time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoption as sons. And because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. Therefore, you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. Notice, this doesn't say anything about a plus. Mary is not a plus in our relationship with our God. She is not a part of our journey. She is to be understood as being blessed to be given the privilege of birthing Jesus. And what a privilege and an honor. Some of the Catholics that I've talked to also didn't believe that Mary ever had other kids, that she was a perpetual virgin. She was not a perpetual virgin. James is his brother. John is his brother. And there's another brother, Judas. And then he had two sisters also with him. And so he indeed had others in his life. Now, I went back and was reading and trying to do some research on Mary. This is not Mary. But this is what they say she may have looked like as a young girl. The Bedouins of the day are still living out there, and they live a simple life. She possibly looked like that, lived in a home like this, with different compartments, and there was probably 10 or more people living in these houses together. You can see that this is one family, that this is probably a family somewhat that Mary was dealing with. So think about this. Mary, and we know this through the scriptures, is pregnant now. And we're going to see as she goes forth, she's pregnant now. And Joseph finds out she's pregnant. And it says he wants to hide her away, to put her away. because he was a just man. He didn't want her to be stoned because she could be stoned. But he has already paid the price for her to be his wife. So he's already went through the formality of being making the legal documents in order so that he could marry Mary at appropriate time. And when he finds out she's pregnant, it's interesting that years down the road, 33 years to be exact or so, Jesus is talking to the Pharisees. And the Pharisees, in the middle of that conversation, they make a statement that's a shot at Mary. That's a shot at his birth. I know that you are Abraham's descendants, but you seek to kill me because my word has no place in you. I speak what I have seen with my father, and you do what you have seen with your father. So there's two fathers here he's referring to. They answered and said to him, Abraham is our father. Jesus said to them, If you were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. But now you seek to kill me, a man who has told you the truth, which I heard from God. Abraham did not do this. You do the deeds of your father. He's referring to Satan. And then they said to him, we were not born of fornication. We have one father. You know what they called Jesus? A bastard. You know what they were calling his mom? Imagine what they were calling his mom. Imagine putting yourself in that position to question who Jesus is and make these accusations. So 30 years that rumor had been going around. 30 years there's a rumor been going around that Jesus was illegitimate. That maybe Mary was molested by a relative. Because I read an article that a lot of young girls back in those days that found themselves pregnant were typically impregnated by a family member, because there's so many of them and they all live in one house. We know that that happens. We read in the paper all the time where a relative is doing something to another relative. And so that's the rumor that was going around during Jesus' time about Jesus and about Mary. So you can imagine what that must be like for her. In verse 56, it says, and Mary remained with her about 3 months and returned to her house. Now Elizabeth's full time came for her to be delivered, and she brought forth a son. When neighbors and relatives heard how the Lord had shown great mercy to her, they rejoiced with her. We're going to get into John next week. I wanted to see the completion of this, but let's go back to Mary. And Mary's prayer is a lot like Hannah's prayer. And it's interesting that Mary's prayer stated truths about who God was. Now let me ask you, ladies, how many of you could state some of God's truth about who God is and what his purpose is and what his plan is for you, your family, for mankind, for America, for whatever? How many of us know the Word of God? Understand it, that we could speak it out, that we could, that could be part of our conversation. So when Hannah gets pregnant with Samuel, after being a barren for so many years, and she finds out she's pregnant, she prays a prayer like Hannah. It says, and Hannah prayed and said, my heart rejoices in the Lord. My horn is exalted in the Lord. I smile at my enemies because I rejoice in your salvation. No one is holy like the Lord. I see Mary say the same thing. For there is none beside you now, nor is there any rock like our God. Talk no more so very proudly. Let no arrogance come from your mouth. For the Lord is the God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. The bows of the mighty men are broken, and those who stumble are girded with strength. Those who are full have hired themselves out for bread, and the hungry have ceased to hunger. Even the barren has borne seven, and she who has many children has become feeble. The Lord kills and makes alive. He brings down to the grave and brings up. The Lord makes poor and makes rich. He brings low and lifts up. He raises the poor. Notice she is stating truths about the Lord in her prayer, in her confession of who God is. She keeps going. You know what? We need Bobby Salinas to the kids' church. You want to walk over there? Bobby, sorry to call you out like that. Can you help a brother out? Oh, there it is. Let me go ahead and get this. I'm gonna get into this Mary worship in a little bit. I'm going to show you some things, but I also want to show you this. Therefore, I exhort, first of all, that all supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings and all who are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and reverence, for this is good and acceptable in the sight of God, our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator. That's very important, and that should, you know, and it's interesting that some, I don't think that everybody that's a Catholic worships Mary. Honestly, I don't think the whole church does that. But I think that there is a lot of misaligned beliefs that have been established or been brought forth to a lot of the Catholics, some of us included in that. But it says right here, one mediator between God and man. I remember as a young Christian when I got saved and had that conversation with my mom about Mary. And it's funny because my mom said, well, you know, praying to Mary is like praying, you know, going to me to go to your father for you. And that makes perfect sense because I did that a lot. My kids do that. I think all kids do that. Go to the mother. But this isn't the same. Jesus became basically the mediator. He's the one we come to go to the Father, not the mother to the Son, but the mother to the Son to the Father. And so Jesus is our mediator. He's the one that goes. We don't need a mediator to Jesus. We don't need a priest to introduce us to Jesus. We need a preacher or an evangelist to open up our eyes to the gospel and to preach the gospel to us, but we don't need them to go to God. In the Old Testament, you couldn't go to God unless you went through a priest. The only way to get to God was through a priest, through an ordained priest. In our day and age, you and I have access to God through our prayers, through our faith, direct access. Come boldly to the throne of grace, he says. Come to me. He wants us to come to him. He doesn't want us to find another way around. In due time. And we know Jesus is in due time. And so, we know from experience that people do worship Mary, that they do see something supernatural about Mary. They do bow down to her. They do show honor to these idols, which we were told not to have and not to do. And yet we see it. We see them. I think this is in Los Angeles somewhere. In Exodus 20, it says, you shall not make for yourselves a carved image, any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that is in the earth beneath. That means nothing that you think is God or the Son or Jesus. Nothing that you think you are to make a statue or an idol and bow down to that at all. He doesn't want us to have any visual look of something that we aim our prayers to, because he wants our prayers to be aimed from within our hearts, inside of us, not to an object. Because most of us are superstitious to a certain degree, or we were superstitious when we were young. I mean, you know, when you're a sports player, you're superstitious. You can't help it. I remember when my daughter was playing softball in Little League and we were going to the World Series that year, I wore the same shirt to every game. I wore the same exact shorts to every game. I wore the same shoes to every game. I just brought that juju to the game. And I know what I was doing. I knew I was just kind of psychologically just messing with my mind that I really wasn't believing that there was the clothes doing this, but I couldn't help it. I just wore the same clothes, the same shorts. I just wanted, you know, but I wasn't worshiping it. And it says, you shall not bow down to it. In Deuteronomy 4, it says, take careful heed to yourself. For you saw no form when the Lord spoke to you at Horeb out of the midst of the fire. Notice what he says, you saw no form. And he says that because he was worried that they would go and make a form, put something up. Because if you had a statue in your house, candles around it, and you felt that that was a holy section, you would start leaning on that and praying towards that statue or saying prayers towards the idol or whatever, or just touching it, thinking it would bring you some good luck or help. Or how many of you have a necklace that you go, oh, Lord, please. You See, you can't do that spiritually. I know it doesn't seem like a big deal. I know it may not seem like a, it seems frivolous almost. But think about what you're doing when you do that. You were trying to make a connection with an object to help you in your prayers when all he wants is the sincerity of your heart. The sincerity of your heart and the brokenness of your heart and the sweetness of your heart or the joy of your heart, that's what he wants. He wants it come within, not touching an idol. Say, oh, Lord, the great pumpkin's going to help me today. And then it says, lest you act corruptly and make for yourselves a carved image in the form of any figure, the likeness of a male or a female, the likeness of an animal that is on the earth, or the likeness of a winged bird that flies in the air, the likeness of anything that creeps on the ground, or the likeness of any fish that is in the water beneath the earth. All you bass fishermen can't have a holy bass on your wall to think it's going to bring the next holy bass. Just remind you of the bass you ain't catching. That's all that is. And then it says this, and take heed, lest you lift your eyes to heaven, and when you see the sun, the moon, and the stars, and all the hosts of heaven, you feel driven to worship them and serve them. Paganism is big on this. Which the Lord your God has given to all the peoples under the whole heaven as a heritage. But the Lord has taken you and brought you out of the iron furnace, out of Egypt, to be his people and inheritance as you are to this day. Furthermore, the Lord was angry at me for your sakes. Moses is dealing with them because they keep wanting to go back. I didn't mean to get that one. Oh, yeah. Therefore, know this day and consider in your heart that the Lord himself is God in heaven above and on the earth beneath. There is no other. You shall therefore keep his statutes and his commandments, which I command you today, that it may go well with you and with your children after you, and that you may prolong your days in land, which the Lord your God has given you for all time. I will say this about my Catholic brothers and sisters. I believe God is merciful and gracious. I believe he's very merciful and very gracious. He's not just going to be sending Catholics to hell because they've been mistaught or misled. I believe that the Lord will open up their eyes as we pray for them. I want to spend the next couple of minutes talking about an event that's going to take place in Waco here going into Easter of next year. You know, and most of you that know anything about the Lord, know anything about Scripture, know that we are living in the last days. And when we say the term last days, we don't mean that the earth is about to end, like some people are saying the last days with the climate change stuff. Let me tell you about climate change real quick. I know the one who's going to change the climate. I know the one who uses the climate to get people's attention. And when we read the book of Revelations, there's going to be a lot of climate changing going on. But for now, is the time for revival. It's time for revival to start with us, Christians, not new believers, but Christians. A lot of us that are Christians are compromised. A lot of us that are Christians have been watering down our Christianity. We're a little bit in, we're a little bit out. The scriptures say that judgment must start in the house of God. And so what we're going to believe is God is going to bring fire on his church, not to hurt it, not to judge it, but to purify it. There's a fire coming that's going to judge later. But there's another kind of fire that's going to come on the church. And I believe that what's going to happen is God is going to bring something that's going to cause all of us to hit our knees. It's going to put so much fear in our hearts that we're going to be on our knees crying out for deliverance for us and our children and our friends, because we're going to think that they're going to be lost in whatever's coming. And God's going to use that, because he's used that over the years. As we look at the Old Testament in the book of Judges, we're seeing over and over and over again the people did what was right in their own eyes. How many of you Christians are doing Christianity your own way? Many of you do Christianity your own way. Most of us do. We don't use the word to put our boundaries. We use how we feel in our hearts to make our boundaries. Well, the Lord, that's old school. That's just old ways of thinking. And so you expand those boundaries, and you start making your own boundaries. Oh, God will forgive me. Well, yeah, He'll forgive me. He'll forgive you after He busts you up a couple of times. Because you reap what you sow. And so there's some pastors in town that through different meetings of different people have come to this idea. Jimmy Seibert at Antioch is one of them. Romero Pena, Christ the King, which is also Trump's pastor, one of his pastors, is also on board with this. And there's a Highland Baptist pastor and some Spanish pastors. There was 160 pastors at a luncheon on Tuesday that I was honored to be a part of and go to. David and Annette went with me. And they have this plan, and it's a pilot plan. It's here with us. We're the first city in the United States to do this, and there's one city in Chicago that's doing this. And what they're doing is they're trying to mobilize all the churches in town that will be a part of this, and then do this door knocking. What it is everybody in our church will get it. If you have a smartphone, you'll get this app. In every house in Waco, they want to get prayed over. Every house in Waco, 40-something thousand houses. I think David said there's actually 80,000, but I think their goal is 40,000 in the general area. And the way that's going to work is each church is going to ask each member to find 12 houses, to knock on the door, invite them to church, and to see if there's any needs they'd like for you to pray for. And ask for prayer requests from that house. And so you'll have 12 houses, and you'll have a list, and you'll put in that app, and it'll show that house has been marked. And we're going to try to cover the whole McLennan County by Easter and try to get some of it. There's 60% of Wacoans don't go to church. And so those of us that do go to church and those of us that have found a relationship with Christ, we realize that a relationship with Christ really helps get through this life. Being a Christian has really made our lives better. We were at prison yesterday, and I just said, you know, even if there is no God, even if there is no God and no heaven, I would still choose to live this life, because the last 30 years compared to the first 20 years, these last 30 years have been wonderful. Even through the dark times, God has shown Himself strong. In my old life, when it was dark, it stayed dark. There was no hope coming out of that. There was nothing to pull me out of that. Wishful thinking, maybe praying to the Virgin Mary. But it was when I got my life right with Christ that my life turned around. And so even if there wasn't a heaven, my life is a shining example that faith in Him can change a man's life and change a man's course and change a man's destiny for the better. It don't mean it's always easy. It don't mean it's always good. But good always will come at the end. All things work together for good. All things work together for good for those of us that are in Christ. And so what we're going to do is we're going to do some training. It's simple. And network with these other churches. For one, I think it makes the kingdom of God look powerful. That we're all pastors are coming together, white, black, Hispanic, whatever. You know, most people in this town think we're a Mexican church because Fuentes. That don't sound Mexican. I think the only name that sounds more Mexican is Gonzalez. Villarreal is pretty Mexican too. So we're going to join forces with other churches, and we want to be a part of that. It's not scary. It's not intimidating. You want to be a part of what God is doing. And we want to see God win this city for Christ and not just pray and talk about it, but also put our feet to the ground. And we are a church that's not scared to be busy. Yesterday we came up here and there were people getting ready to go feed the homeless, and we were going to prison. I was just thinking, Lord, thank you for all these different things, these different opportunities you give our church to be a part of and be a blessing to this community. And I encourage you to get involved and get your feet wet and see what it's like and taste it and see. And so we're going to be doing this evangelism outreach with these other host churches. and hopefully get every church in Waco covered, every house in Waco covered. And I pray that your heart for the Lord will also fire you up to be an evangelist and share the gospel, or at least invite people to church. And whether this church or another church is more like them, I guess, but because I am not everybody's cup of tea. I know that already. So I'm thankful to be a part of a great church. I'm thankful for the Word of God and what it teaches us. And I hope that today I didn't offend anybody with what I said about Mary or your family about Mary. But I think that as Christians, we need to understand that we need to let the Word of God challenge us or challenge our beliefs rather than how we feel or what we think about something just because we were raised that way. I think we need to be willing and be open to the Holy Spirit to rearrange some of our thoughts and rearrange some of our understanding so that we can get the fullness of what all Christ has for us. And understanding that his virgin birth, how important it was not about making Mary famous. It was about birthing Christ. She became famous. She was blessed. She had to live with a stigmatism her whole life of being, you know, a wayward woman, basically. Or unfaithful woman, but we will see how powerful she was in the life of Christ. She was a powerful influence in the life of Christ. And I pray that as God begins to birth things in your life, that you will also let the Lord use you before he comes back. Because he's coming back. Or you're going to die first. One or the other. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Lord, that you're so strategic, Lord, in your prophecies, how far back you started prophesying. You said before the foundation of the world, you were set in place to die for our sins, Lord God. Before you created the world, you already had this wonderful plan. And if many of us would just understand that there has been a plan since the beginning and that we are a part of the plan, and especially if we are your children, Lord God, we are part of the good plan and not the bad. And I pray for those in here, Lord God, who don't know you, who've never committed their hearts to you. I pray in Jesus' name that hearts are turned to you this morning. Father, those that sit in darkness, I pray that your light shine upon them. And Lord, we thank you for all those in this room who served in our military. We thank you for all the veterans who served and gave themselves away for this country, Lord God. In any capacity, we are so thankful, Lord God, for men and women who would give themselves for their country. And we pray special blessings on them and special blessings on their family and on their health. We pray for those in here this morning who are going through physical sickness, illness, anything, Lord God. We pray for deliverance. We pray for wholeness, Lord God. We want to be used by you, and we need to be healthy to do it. And Father God, I just pray for peace and healing and wholeness in this place. In Jesus' name. And everybody said, go Cowboys.
now you're